Hello, my colleagues everywhere. I am Amr Abouelela, consultant intensivist in military hospital in Saudi Arabia and professor of critical care in Alexandria University in Egypt. It's my pleasure to present this briefing or summary today as a part or as a final part of this course, COVID-19 advanced course. Actually, it's very difficult to mention everything about the course in a single presentation. But I will try to go to the important essential points that every intensivist should know about the COVID-19 management. And for details, you can refer to the specific lectures to go for more and more detailed instructions. Actually, I use this guideline. This is our local protocol in the military hospital, critical care guidelines and the protocol of management of COVID-19. From the ICU department, King Fahd Military Medical Complex. I will go through the details of the protocol to highlight the important essential point, as I mentioned, and you can go to details in other lectures. These outlines, I will try to highlight some important epidemiological consideration. Then I will go to the diagnosis, clinical, laboratory, and radiological. We'll discuss the severity of cases, mild versus moderate and severe cases. And very important point is the infection control and safety precaution of the healthcare professional. For the management, we'll go to some general points about the management. Airway and ventilatory strategy, we mentioned it very briefly. You can go to the lecture for more details. Also the same for hemodynamic optimization. We will mention only the headlines of this topic, a big topic. Also the renal involvement and CRRT, we will mention briefly. And a small hint also about the medications. Epidemiology. As you know, the coronavirus 2019 or COVID-19, also mentioned as SARS-CoV-2, is an RNA virus. It's a single-stranded RNA enveloped virus. Targets cells through a certain spike protein, the S protein here, and it's target mainly the angiotensin-converting enzyme 2 receptor, which is present in the wall of the alveoli in the lung. Also, it's present in the small intestine and in the kidney. That's why the affection of the coronavirus may be multisystemic, affecting the lung, also the kidney, and maybe the intestine, causing ischemia of the bowel and sometimes pneumatosis intestinalis. There is many presentation of the COVID-19 virus. For the lung here, you can see the S protein is coming and cleaving this AC receptor, and then the virus is getting entry inside the alveoli and starting its replication process. As you know, the virus started mainly from animals, the bats and pangolins, and then it's transmitted to the human. And unfortunately, now that the spread start to be person to person. Virus shedding is very early and high in the early in the course of the disease. One important question: can a symptomatic carrier be a source of infection? The answer is unfortunately yes, because the human beings start to shed the virus 1 or 2 days prior to the start of symptoms. So a symptomatic person can be a carrier and can transmit the disease to others. Although the viral load before the start of symptoms will be very low, and the possibility of transmitting the infection is not very high, but still present. Generally, virus shedding continue for 7 to 10 days from the starting of the symptoms in mild cases, but it can last more than 2 weeks, 14 days in severe cases, and the maximum time for virus shedding is 37 days. It's a very long time, especially considering this time in severe cases, that they can continue to be infectious for a long time and need to be isolated to avoid transmission or spread of the disease. Mode of transmission, basically it's a respiratory droplet, and it will be transmitted with close contact with expulsion of the cough and sneezing for 3 to 6 feet. And in some data and some studies, they are also considering higher distance of spreading of infection. So the isolation or the distancing is very important to avoid the transmission of the disease. Also, it can contaminate surfaces for a long time, and I will show you in one of the next slides how long the virus can stay in different surfaces, and it's very important considering the cleaning and the disinfection of the surfaces in the ICU around the patient, because the virus can stay for a long time. Possibility of aerosol transmission also is there, especially in ICU setting. It's a closed setting with prolonged exposure from the healthcare professional to the patient and the recurrent repeated exposure. Also, high viral load is there during coughing and sneezing and aerosol producing procedure, like during intubation, extubation, during using non-invasive high flow nasal cannula. All this aerosol producing procedure is considered a high risk procedure, and aerosol transmission can be there, and so maximum precautions should be taken by the physician and nurses while doing this procedure and considering the aerosol transmission in this setting. Actually, it's come from close contact with symptomatic cases, of course. Also, the virus is detected in some of the stool specimen. However, fecal oral route transmission is not clear until now. Very important, as I mentioned, persistence of the virus on the surface. You can see on the aluminium surface, it can stay from 2 to 8 hours. Also on the surgical gloves, it can stay for 8 hours. In the steel, 48 hours. For other substances like wood, glass, paper, and plastic, it can stay from 4 to 5 days. It's a very long time. So you should consider very careful cleaning of all the surface around the patient. Otherwise, the virus will stay and it will be a source of transmission to other patients. At diagnosis, 80% of patients will be asymptomatic or mild to moderate disease. Only 15% will be presented with severe presentation, and 5% will be very critical. With progression of the disease, 15% of the mild cases will turn to severe cases, and 15% of severe cases will be critical. So it's very important not to consider the mild and moderate cases as a stable patient and no danger. No, because a large proportion of this patient can be turned to be very serious later on. So we should keep an eye on all your patients. Unfortunately, also that 75% of asymptomatic patients at the time of the diagnosis can have active disease later on during the course. Essential interval to remember from exposure to the virus to start of the appearance of the symptoms, it's around 5 to 6 days, can be up to 2 weeks, the incubation period. And remember this date, please. The critical date is between day 9 and 10. This is the time. It's very important for us as intensivists, because from the start of the exposure, start of the beginning of the symptoms for the patient sometimes is very stable, but by day 9 of 10, the incidence of hypoxia, dyspnea, progression of the dyspnea, and development of real respiratory failure happen at this date. So you should keep an eye not to miss the patient on this critical stage, and consider that stable or asymptomatic or mild cases can be turned to be very severe later on. From symptom onset to recovery, for mild cases it will take 2 weeks if the patient will not progress to the critical or severe form, as I mentioned. And for the severe cases, recovery can be long, take up to 6 weeks, from 3 to 6 weeks. From symptom onset to death, it's variable from 2 up to 8 weeks. It's according to the severity of disease, of course, and to the medical service provided to the patient as well. Last point in the epidemiology is very important and a repeated question: is there any role for BCG vaccine? And today we have one important study published in JAMA, 13 May. SARS-CoV-2 rates in BCG vaccinated and unvaccinated young adult. And actually the result is here, that comparing the vaccinated versus non-vaccinated person, and the incidence of the virus, it's 11 versus 10%. It seems there is no difference. And actually I believe there is no role for this BCG vaccine. I think it's useless, and we should not rely too much on this point. To move now to the second part, start the diagnosis of COVID-19, clinical symptoms, as you know, is presented mostly by dry cough in 60% of cases, fever up to 45% on presentation, but later on during the course of the disease, more than 85% will have fever at the time of or during any stage of the progress of the disease. Dyspnea in 30% of cases, rhinorrhea, odynophagia, anosmia, it's not very common, maybe in 15% only. GI symptoms, nausea, diarrhea, vomiting in 10%. As you see, all the symptoms are more or less non-specific from other causes of common cold, flu, pneumonia. So you should carry on this stage now the disease is spread all over the world now. In every country, you should have high degree or high index of suspicion. If you have a patient presenting with these symptoms, you should think about the possibility of COVID-19 infection. Moreover, the disease can be presented by anyone apart from these standard symptoms. It can be the disease can be presented in advanced or complicated course, like heart failure, renal failure, multiple organ failure. As I mentioned, can be presented by intestinal ischemia. Any complication can happen, and you should suspect the COVID-19 symptoms and complication in any patient now. Important laboratory data related to the COVID-19, like the lymphopenia and specific count less than 800 is considered very significant to consider the lymphopenia. High C-reactive protein, high LDH, D-dimer, ferritin, interleukin-6, and possibility of high also liver function, AST, ALT, renal function, BUN, creatinine. Initially normal procalcitonin, as it's viral infection, the procalcitonin is supposed to be normal. And most important, of course, is PCR from a nasopharyngeal swab or respiratory sample. Nasopharyngeal swab sensitivity is very important because you should know that the sensitivity is not very high, and you should not rely on the negative result to exclude totally the COVID-19 possibility. For taking the swab, don't forget that it's an aerosol-producing procedure, and you should take full protective equipment, and the sample should be taken, of course, in a negative pressure room to avoid any spread of the virus or contamination or spread to the healthcare professional also. This is the important data revealing the sensitivity of the nasal swab, which is only here 63%. It means that for every 3 patients with COVID-19 swabbed, only 2 will come positive, and there is 1 false negative result will appear. Also here, the sputum sensitivity is only 75%, while the bronchoalveolar lavage or deep tracheal aspirate, the sensitivity can be increased to 93%. That's why it's recommended if the patient is intubated to repeat the sample, because the yield of the deep tracheal aspirate or bronchoalveolar lavage sample will be much higher than the nasopharyngeal or regular sputum sample. Also, the technique of obtaining the swab from the nasopharyngeal swab is very important to get the highest possible accurate results. Radiological findings with COVID-19, we'll go to the X-ray, the point of care ultrasound, and the CT diagnosis. X-ray is the standard of care. You should ask yourself 3 important questions. If the patient has fever or cough, or he has lymphopenia or high C-reactive protein, or he has a chest X-ray finding matching with COVID-19, you should not actually proceed to the CT if all the 3 questions are positive. There is symptoms, there is a laboratory finding and radiological finding matching with COVID, so the patient has COVID with no doubt and no need to proceed for CT, only X-ray is enough. What we found in the X-ray? We'll have initially bilateral peripheral infiltration in the form of ground glass opacity in the early stage, and later on we can find also the consolidations, mainly in the lower lobes. But don't forget that 1/3 of the cases at initial presentation, if the patient were presented very early, they can have normal X-ray on presentation. And in this particular situation, if you have a high degree of suspicion and history and laboratory finding matching with COVID-19, in this situation, maybe you have to proceed for CT or ultrasound for more confirmation. X-ray finding, as we mentioned, it will be peripheral, mainly ground glass appearance, and by time it may progress also to some more dense consolidations. This is some of the COVID-19 X-ray of real cases. You can see the infiltration in some situation, it's ground glass opacity peripheral, and sometimes the opacity increased to have a very dense consolidation. Ultrasound, what we will find in the COVID-19 patient, it's a picture of pneumonitis, non-homogeneous, more in the lower zones, the lateral and posterior zones. We will find the pleural thickening, a regular pleural line, focal patchy B lines, subpleural consolidation, and sometimes dynamic air bronchograms matching with significant consolidation. This is some of the example what we can see here. You can see the abnormality, irregular pleural line with some subpleural consolidation. These white dots, it's subpleural consolidation. You can see here also some white dots of subpleural consolidation, irregular pleural line. Here you can see the consolidation, dense, very dense consolidation, air bronchogram, dynamic air bronchogram. And the B lines, which is not different from any patient with pulmonary edema. Sometimes it's difficult to differentiate the pulmonary edema from the lung infiltration with the COVID-19. And sometimes the B lines will be like single B lines like this, or it be confluent, very dense, like in this situation. CT findings for COVID-19, it's mainly as X-ray, it's peripheral bilateral ground glass appearance with or without consolidation. Consolidation, as we mentioned, will appear in late stage with this crazy paving also. You can see initially the ground glass appearance like this in the periphery, small, and later on you can find more dense area of consolidation. This is also a picture of crazy paving, this hexagonal picture of the alveoli. This is due to affection of the alveoli, and then super added also more infiltration in the interstitial or septal space separating the alveoli and lobules. So we'll start to have this crazy paving or this hexagonal opacities. And later on, you can see more dense consolidation. Don't forget that the sensitivity of the CT is very high, 97%, but unfortunately it's not very specific. The specificity is only 25%, because these findings of ground glass and consolidation, it's not very different from different cause of viral pneumonia or atypical bacterial pneumonia. You can find the same picture with other diagnosis rather than COVID-19. So you should consider this point. Not all patients with this picture always have COVID-19, but if you have a normal CT, maybe you will have some confidence to say this patient has no COVID-19, because also the CT findings are very early and it's starting earlier than the X-ray finding, of course. Severity of illness, as we mentioned, it will range from asymptomatic patient, mild to moderate cases with no evidence of pneumonia, and then severe cases. We are considering severe cases if you have a respiratory rate more than 30, oxygen saturation less than 93, or PF ratio less than 300, or lung infiltrates less than 50%. Lung infiltrates more than 50%. And we'll consider the critical severity of disease if the patient start to have multiple organ failure in the form of ARDS, septic shock, altered sensorium, multiple organ failure, acute kidney injury, and so on. Of course, as ICU physician, we are concerned much more with the severe and critical classification. This is the ICU concern, because this patient should be treated, of course, in the ICU. But as I mentioned before, don't forget that a good proportion from asymptomatic or mild cases, maybe after 1 week or 10 days, they may progress to severe or critical patients. So you should keep an eye on this patient also, or you should arrange with the medical ward that this patient should be under close observation at any time they started to deteriorate. You should be moved to the ICU setting. Criteria for ICU admission is not different from other patient, regular general patient. Any patient with hemodynamic instability, patient with respiratory failure requiring invasive or non-invasive ventilation, decreased level of conscious, major organ dysfunction requiring intensive care support. And of course, the criteria of ICU admission will be managed according to the overall hospital situation of the, if the ICU is very overwhelmed and very busy, maybe you'll start to manage some cases of mild respiratory failure and non-invasive ventilation. Maybe you'll start to manage in the regular ward, and it needs special arrangement with the hospital administration according to the disaster plan in your hospital. Decision of ICU admission, of course, will be taken by the ICU consultant on charge, and very early involvement of the ID, it's important to discuss the plan of management regarding the antiviral and antimicrobial antibiotic and so on. It should be combined management regarding this part. Some of the general points or general management in ICU, of course, regarding the isolation of safety, as I mentioned, very important point. Patient should be admitted in a negative pressure room if available. Standard and contact using double gloves isolation and droplet isolation also is the standard of care for all patients. But don't forget to apply airborne isolation and using N95 respirator and full suit during any aerosol producing procedure like intubation, extubation, bronchoscopy, non-invasive ventilation and so on, because the spread of infection will be very high during this procedure. All healthcare professionals should put personal protective equipment, including full cover-all suit, fitted N95 respirator, and face shield and goggles as well. Protective equipment should be done and doffed under supervision of a trained observer, because a lot of fallacies or failure happening because it's not applied properly. The putting the protective equipment and removing it should be done initially under supervision until everyone is confident enough that he's doing it properly to avoid any spread of infection. Routine workup upon ICU admission. All the routine labs should be done, including the inflammatory marker, D-dimer, C-reactive protein, procalcitonin, ferritin, and so on. And the important point also to check also for the COVID-19 serology, namely the immunoglobulin M and G. I will come to this in the next slide. Ultrasound chest also to assess and IVC to assess the fluid responsiveness and to see the fluid status of the patient. Very important to consider baseline echocardiography, ECG, and troponin, considering the possibility or high possibility of cardiac involvement of those patients to present with cardiomyopathy, and also in case you will treat the patient with this hydroxychloroquine. So the ECG is mandatory for calculation of the corrected QT. Immunoglobulin G and M is very important, although the sensitivity in the first week for the PCR is higher, 67% versus only 29 or 19% for immunoglobulin. But in the second week, as you see, the sensitivity of immunoglobulin M will increase to 73% versus only 54% for the PCR test. It's very obvious here from this graph that the curve of PCR is starting earlier and then coming after 4 weeks to zero. Here's the immunoglobulin M. You can see it's starting after 7 days and up to 3 weeks. The most important point for me here is the immunoglobulin G, because it's starting late after 2 weeks, and then it will remain positive for a very long time, denoting long-term immunity. So it's very important to checking immunoglobulin G. Nowadays you have a long time since the start of the virus, maybe 3, 4 months, 6 months now. But we should proceed to know what is the immunoglobulin G status for every patient. Maybe this patient has the infection before and he has now immunity from COVID-19 if he has a positive immunoglobulin G. General measures for treatment, adequate nutritional assessment and starting diet is very important. Nutritional support if no contraindication. And you can refer, of course, to the specific lecture about the nutrition in COVID-19. GI prophylaxis for high-risk patient, all ventilated patients are high-risk should receive GI prophylaxis. Some important supplement, vitamin B, thiamine, vitamin C, vitamin D, and zinc is very important, especially vitamin D, and is recommended to give very high dose, especially in severe cases, up to 3 grams every 6 hours IV vitamin C. Potassium and magnesium supplementation is very important to keep higher level of potassium more than 4 and magnesium more than 1, especially if you are using drugs prolonging the QT as azithromycin and hydroxychloroquine to prevent the occurrence of lethal arrhythmia, of course. Try to avoid nebulization and respiratory treatment and use only a metered dose inhaler if required to prevent the spread of infection with using of the nebulization, regular nebulization. Paracetamol is a point that is very important to control the fever. You can use paracetamol only if temperature more than 38.5. Some of people believe that the fever is a protective mechanism. It's a part of the defense mechanism of the body. Some people also think that if the fever is very high, it may add to the lung injury and the inflammatory process of the body, and it can increase the risk of complication. So we agree that a higher temperature, only more than 38.5, should be controlled. Less than that, we can keep the temperature or the fever as a protective mechanism. And don't forget also that the fever is one of the mechanisms increasing the oxygen consumption. And if the patient is suffering from hypoxia, you will be faced by an imbalance between the oxygen delivery and oxygen consumption. And in this situation, it's better to try to control the fever if you have a real hypoxia. Codeine also, we added in our protocol to use codeine 60 milligram every 6 to 8 hours to control the cough in the initial stage of the disease in non-ventilated patient, because it was found also that the continuous cough happening with COVID-19 is adding on to the pressure on the lung and increasing the incidence of acute lung injury. So early control of cough, maybe it will help. And this is what we get from the Chinese experience. They are suppressing the cough with some Chinese herb from the very early beginning of the disease in the first 2 days. Also avoid using non-steroidal. The recommendation is coming mainly from the ibuprofen, but it's applied for all non-steroidal. It's better to avoid it if possible. Talking about the anticoagulation, I will go very briefly about this French study done on 129 patients, and they did CT angio for them and average on day 9, and what they all found, they found that 23% of patients, they develop pulmonary embolism, which is very high incidence, and it's adding on to the mechanism of hypoxia and respiratory failure in COVID-19. So consideration of very early anticoagulation and considering also the high incidence of pulmonary embolism is very important to guide your therapy. Another paper also considering a new term of pulmonary intravascular coagulopathy, PIC, which is similar to DIC. We have now the PIC as a pulmonary intravascular coagulopathy. One of the mechanisms suggested for the mechanism of hypoxia in this COVID-19 respiratory failure. And associated with endothelial injuries, adding too much to the hypoxia in this kind of patient. Another study considering the autopsy of some of the patient died with COVID-19, and you can see clearly here that there is some embolization points here with the arrow. There is pulmonary embolism, really micro and macro emboli with this COVID-19 patients. So what we think that the anticoagulation is very critical point. The COVID-19 is associated with hypercoagulable state with pulmonary micro and macrovascular disease, playing a significant role in the hypoxia and pulmonary shunting and VQ mismatch. Prophylaxis dose of enoxaparin should be considered initially from 40 up to 80 milligram daily in high-risk patient. And we should consider full anticoagulation in severe cases if there is high suspicion of pulmonary embolism or hypercoagulable state. And we decided about these two indicators, the D-dimer more than 1 and arterial end-tidal CO2 gap of CO2 gap between the arterial and end-tidal value more than 10, suggesting also high possibility of pulmonary embolism. We will consider at this stage full anticoagulation with enoxaparin, the regular dose, and to be adjusted with according to the creatinine clearance. So the anticoagulation is a very critical point. I cannot discuss it more, but you can refer also to the specific lecture to see what is mentioned about it. Steroids is not indicated routinely. Actually, it's discouraged to be used in this kind of COVID-19 as a mainly a viral pneumonia disease, because using steroids, it will prolong the shedding of the virus from the patient and more spread of the infection. However, we have two only indication to use steroids cautiously. If you have a septic shock requiring high dose of vasopressor, you'll use the recommendation of hydrocortisone 200 milligram daily. Also, the other indication, if the pneumonia will progress to severe persistent ARDS, not responding to the usual treatment, so you are justified here to start steroids while using, there is a lot of protocols, you know, for steroids in ARDS. You are using this Midori protocol, starting methylprednisolone intravenous infusion, 1 milligram per kilogram body weight per day. And this is a very specific indication, as I mentioned, severe ARDS or severe or refractory septic shock are the only indication to start steroid. It's not indicated routinely. Ventilatory management in COVID-19, actually there is a lot of details about this point. You can refer to my lecture about the ventilatory strategy in COVID-19 and how there are a lot of consideration. I will try to go briefly to this algorithm you are using in our hospital, just to summarize what we mentioned. Don't forget initially that the pathophysiology of the respiratory failure is multifactorial, and you should understand the pathophysiology for each patient at each stage of the disease, because it's very important to tailor the management, and the respiratory management should be individualized, as I mentioned, according to the patient. Not the same protocol can fit all patients, and the management also will change from day to day according to the progress of different pathophysiological points regarding the occurrence of shunt, dead space, self-inflicted lung injury, and so on. Here's the algorithm of our management for respiratory management protocol. Don't forget, of course, if you go for intubation, the safety precaution. You can refer to the airway also lecture. Pull your full protective equipment, airborne isolation. Use the safety box if you have it. No bagging to prevent spread of infection, and use rapid sequence intubation with video laryngoscope to facilitate and keep the procedure more quickly. And the most experienced skilled person should proceed for the intubation, of course. We are starting with regular oxygen here, starting regular nasal cannula or face mask if the patient can achieve his target, saturation more than 94, PO2 more than 60, pH more than 7.25. If you are not able to achieve the target, you will proceed with the next step. If there is deterioration of the patient, you will go down from the first step to the next step. High flow nasal cannula non-invasive ventilation, and you should consider early intubation at this stage if the patient is not improving. And I mentioned in the lecture of ventilatory strategy, it's very important while applying this short trial of non-invasive or high flow nasal cannula to keep an eye not only on the oxygenation but on the work of breathing, because continuous high work of breathing, it will add to the lung injury to the patient, and we will have a bad outcome. If the work of breathing is not improving, you should proceed early with intubation, and don't rely too much on the improvement of oxygenation while the patient is still struggling with high work of breathing. This will increase the patient's self-inflicted lung injury, as I mentioned. Consider the awake proning during non-invasive or high flow nasal cannula. It's a very promising technique to start to have a prone position while the patient is still awake. It gives very good result and improve the oxygenation and reducing too much the VQ mismatch is improving too much with this protocol. If the patient is not doing well with this step of the non-invasive, you should proceed for the invasive mechanical ventilation. Basically, you should be stuck to the basic protocol, maybe of ARDS, low tidal volume, 6 to 8 ml per kg, PEEP titration, starting with low PEEP and increasing the PEEP according to the situation. You should keep in mind the plateau pressure should not exceed 30. Driving pressure also is very important, and I highlight the importance of the driving pressure on the ventilatory strategy lecture. Driving pressure less than 14. applying also the prone position with other risk management like using steroids and muscle relaxant in severe cases with PF ratio less than 150. At this stage, you should measure the compliance. If the compliance is not very bad, more than 40, you should consider the L phenotype described by Professor Gattinoni, these two different phenotypes, type 1 or phenotype L, a picture of pneumonitis. You should consider using lower PEEP, using some agents as a pulmonary vasodilator like the nitric oxide or the inhaled prostaglandins. And if the compliance is very low, you should deal with the patient as a phenotype H or classical ARDS. You should consider using higher PEEP recruitment maneuver, and you should consider also very important the transpulmonary pressure. It's very important to use it if it's available in your hospital. It's a very important technology to differentiate between the compliance of the lung and the compliance of the chest wall and respiratory system, and it will help you too much to titrate your PEEP to the optimum level. And don't forget to consider also a special mode of ventilation, which is airway pressure release ventilation, if you are not fulfilling good result with the basic management. And there is a special lecture, very important, with airway pressure release ventilation. It's a good modality. Finally, if you are not able to achieve your target for more than 6 hours with refractory hypoxia with PF ratio less than 100, you should consider using the ECMO. It's used in only selected cases because it's very difficult to use ECMO in case of a large number of COVID-19, the resources of the hospital. All hospital, you should not apply ECMO except for very selected patients. You think the prognosis will be good for them. This is the basic management we are applying with all modalities of respiratory support and applying the COVID-19 protocol and considering the phenotype L and phenotype H described previously by Dr. Gattinoni. Interestingly, I saw yesterday or day before yesterday a new study considering now three different phenotypes, not only two. I just put it for interest. They are considering from the CT pattern in COVID-19. They divided into three different categories, not only two. The first one, which is the phenotype 1, matching with the ground glass opacity, and they are considering here the overperfusion of the alveoli with the first mechanism of the hypoxia, which is the shunt, considering good aeration of the alveoli with overperfusion or overflow of the vasculature or pulmonary vasculature due to vasoplasia or loss of vasomotor tone. Adding on more hypoxia to the patient with actually good compliance, which is matching mainly with the phenotype L described by Professor Gattinoni. And the phenotype 3 here, which is classical ARDS, is a patchy pattern, considering very low compliance here with this kind of lung or ventilation ARDS pattern. And in between phenotype 1 and phenotype 3, they describe an intermediate phenotype, which is phenotype 2, distributed mainly due to atelectasis and peribronchial opacity. It's still another hypothesis. And every day, I guess we will have a new suggestion and a new classification. Just I put it for interest, but I think it will not be too different from the management. They are considering here, of course, low PEEP. Here, moderate to high PEEP, and in the severe ARDS, higher level of PEEP. Your hemodynamic management, it's a very big topic, actually. There is one or more lecture covering this topic, the hemodynamic management, but I will go through the highlights, the principal point that everyone should know. Actually, here you should use, of course, the dynamic parameter to assess fluid responsiveness, because the fluid responsiveness or the fluid status control is very important on this setting. We should not give too much fluid to avoid overload on the lung, more congestion and more hypoxia. And we should not keep the patient dry also to avoid more complication. So using the dynamic parameters is very important, like the IVC respiratory variation by ultrasound. Velocity time integral of the aortic valve by echocardiography is a very good tool also if you are able, you have the skills and the machine to do it. Pulse contour technology is a PICO machine measuring the stroke volume variation, pulse pressure variation, or using the passive leg raising test, all are these parameters are considered dynamic parameters for fluid responsive, you can apply it. Importance and role of capnogram and end-tidal CO2 is very crucial because you should measure the cardiac output response to fluid in this kind of patient. And if you are not able to do the VTI and you don't have a pulse contour technology or PICO machine, you will not be able to check the cardiac output. But if you don't have these tools and you have a capnogram, which is very essential to have a capnogram for all patients with COVID-19, you can use the end-tidal CO2 as a surrogate for the cardiac output. By increasing the end-tidal CO2 by more than 15%, you should consider this a positive response to any fluid challenge. If the cardiac output or the CO2 is increasing by 15% or more, you should consider your patient as a responsive patient and you can give him fluid comfortably and he will benefit from it. Fluid resuscitation should be done by balanced crystalloids. Fluid management strategy should be balanced. Actually, you are, of course, all of us agree about the recommendation of using restrictive fluid strategy for ARDS, and I totally agree, especially if the patient is severely hypoxic. But don't forget also that a lot of patients will develop renal failure. We'll come to this on the next slides. So you should consider careful fluid titration, not to be overdoing or over diuresing the patient to be faced with a complication of renal failure. If I am suggesting if the patient is not very hypoxic, to have a balanced strategy of fluid rather than restrictive strategy. And also consider the high insensible fluid loss, especially with high fever and patient on the ventilator. You are counting the balance from your chart, but don't forget that there is a lot of fluid loss which is not counted in your chart, which is the insensible fluid loss. Basic management, of course, norepinephrine is still the drug of choice to reach MAP more than 65. Vasopressin can be used as alternative. Dobutamine also can be considered in case of cardiac dysfunction documented by echo or by PICO machine if you have pulse contour technology. Hydrocortisone, as you mentioned, to be added in refractory shock cases. Routine management like serial management of serum lactate, arterial line insertion for all patients, cardiac output monitor if you are using high dose of norepinephrine, all of these are applied. And for more details, it's better to refer to the hemodynamic management lecture. AKI and COVID-19, I will go very briefly. There is a special lecture for this one, but just to know that the incidence of acute kidney injury with COVID-19 in some reports is 25%. Up to 1 out of 4 patients of COVID-19 will develop acute kidney injury. The mechanism suggested for AKI is multifactorial, impairment of gas exchange, hemodynamic alteration, especially right-sided failure with severe ARDS, maybe fluid overload, sepsis. And don't forget also this point I mentioned in the first slide, that the SARS-CoV or COVID-19, they are attacking the angiotensin-converting enzyme 2 receptor, which is present in the renal tubules as well as the lung. So the virus can have direct invasion to the kidney, and this is one of the suggested mechanisms of acute kidney injury in AKI. Kidney involvement also in many papers discussed, and some of them are referring to the pathology related to cytokine damage and release of these mediators, and another to organ crosstalk between the lung and kidney and different mechanisms. But anyway, you should consider that the kidney involvement and renal failure is happening in a high proportion of your patient. Renal replacement therapy, you should go with regular routine management. Indication, if you have AKI, acute kidney injury or fluid overload, you can do SCUF to remove extra fluid from the lung. Aggressive anticoagulation is very important. If you have citrate, it's preferable, of course, because the high incidence of hypercoagulable state with COVID-19, as we mentioned before. As an access for dialysis, the best is right jugular to avoid excessive clotting, and also it will be very comfortable for you if you are using proning position to avoid any dislodgement or any compression on the line. Some of the specific treatment for COVID-19, you have, of course, one very elegant lecture for one of the expert, Dr. Tariq Musawi, ICU consultant and ID consultant. He will talk in details about all the medication suggested for this one. But I will go briefly as a summary that all the medication till now, it's off-label and still under investigation and can be tried only in life-threatening condition as a risk therapy. And it's off-label use also. So according to our local hospital policy protocol, we should fill an off-label form filling if you are will use any of this medication. And the family should sign also that you know that this patient are using it off-label. Many medication are considered as antiviral group like hydroxychloroquine, caletra, lopinavir, ritonavir, remdesivir, flavipiravir, the Japanese drug, the Avigan. A lot of study considering these agents, other patients like tocilizumab, the Actemra, interleukin-6 blocker, convalescent plasma, others like IVIG and interferon. The most important, if you are using some of this medication, of course, with some of antibiotics, azithromycin and others, don't forget to apply this good website for drug-drug interaction, because if you are using a lot of medication, you will be faced also with some interaction for the drugs, but it's better to revise yourself with this site to see what interaction you will have to adjust your drugs or your doses of medication to avoid any side effects. Actually, maybe the problem with the medication we are giving, if you have no clear evidence of benefit, we should consider also the harm. Sometimes we are offering the patient this medication, we will add on to his complication side effects and harming him more than giving him any benefits. Important paper in the JAMA, Pharmacological Treatment for Coronavirus Disease. It's very nice illustration here showing how the virus is entering the alveoli. As I mentioned, there is cleaving of ACE2 receptor by the S-spike protein of the virus. Then the virus will go inside the alveoli, start its replication, proteolysis, and this RNA polymerase reaction. The virus starts to replicate here and then continue his life cycle and go all through. So it's very important to understand the mechanism of the virus or the life cycle of the virus inside the alveoli and the cell, and to understand how the medication is working. Because if you understand, you will understand when to use the medication and why it's bad to use it or useless to use it late. Chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, the mechanism suggested for function, it's appear to block the viral entry into the cells, stopping the virus from getting entrance inside the cell and stopping its life cycle very early, if possible. Other medication like lopinavir, ribavir, and remdesivir, flavipiravir, they are stopping completion of assembly and the replication of virus by blocking this proteolysis or RNA polymerase reaction. So they stop the replication of the virus inside the cell. That's why it's very important to understand if you are using this medication in a late stage of the disease, maybe this step, it will already bypass and the virus start its replication and assembly and it will be useless, you will not stop anything. And you should understand also one important point regarding the mechanism of this medication or how the disease is running. In the first week of the disease, all the symptoms and signs will be mostly related to the invasion of the virus and its direct action on the cells and alveoli and so on. After the first week, you should consider also the immune response of the body and the symptoms at this stage and the release of cytokines and the multiple organ failure happening. It's an interaction between the virus and the immune response of the body, and maybe it's not wise at this stage only to target the virus. You should think more global than that, and that's why maybe it's important to consider some of the medication like tocilizumab or this one, because it's binding or blocking the interleukin-6 receptor, and this is one of the mediators leading to the cytokine storm happening around day 8 to 10 from the start of the symptoms. So you are here try to make some immunomodulation of the body and its reaction to the virus. I will not go too much about the details of hydroxychloroquine. It's used in doses of 400 milligram BID first day and 200 BID for 4 days. The most important for me, if you use it, to consider as a high risk lethal arrhythmia. If you have a prolonged QT more than 500 millisecond or more than 25% increase from the baseline, you should stop or revise your medication. So it's important to keep an eye on the ECG daily, to check the QT interval, and to check daily potassium and magnesium, and to keep it on the higher level. The initiation of hydroxychloroquine is very serious medication. It should be done in ICU supervision and by agreement of the ID and ICU team altogether. The initial data starting almost 2 months now from France about this study treating with a combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin and having some good result. Actually, the number of cases is very, very limited. It's only 20 cases treated, and they show some significant reduction of the viral load. And the group treated with azithromycin and hydroxychloroquine, it's very strange, it was only 6 patients, and they have more efficient virus elimination, but only 6 patients, it's very limited study. Many other trial done, one in China using a randomized controlled trial on 150 hospitalized patients, and the conclusion that they have no benefit and more side effects. More and more negative data also, another important observational study from USA, from New York, 1,376 patients and follow-up of 22 days, and finally they found that the result is the same. The Kaplan-Meier curve probability of event-free. Event-free means the incidence of intubation or death, and actually there was no significant finding between the hydroxychloroquine group in red color and the non-hydroxychloroquine in blue color, and the result is they're negative, no significant association between the hydroxychloroquine and intubation. This is the Saudi FDA recommendation released on 24th of April, almost 3 weeks ago. They are clearly discouraging using the hydroxychloroquine outside of its current indication at this time, other than in clinical trial setting. If you are not applying a clinical trial, they are not encouraging too much using it. Another study from USA is the same. It's a retrospective multicenter on a large number of patients, 1,400. They have 4 groups, one receiving hydroxychloroquine azithromycin, one group receiving hydroxychloroquine only, azithromycin only, and the fourth group is the control, not receiving any drugs, and actually they found nothing the same. All the 4 groups are the same, no significant improvement or no significant positive effect of using this medication. Actually, for me, my personal impression is that the page should be closed for this hydroxychloroquine, should not be used anymore, because all the data are coming are very negative. We are only adding side effects with this drug and no clear benefit for our patients. But still, because of the lack of the gap of knowledge, and there is no good medication so far, still it's present even in our hospital protocol. We did not remove it from the protocol, and all the hospital, I think all over the world, they are still applying it. But if it's not used in the context of clinical trial, I think it's not wise to use it on individual basis because of the serious side effects. The other drug, which is the Caletra, which is initially in HIV management, lopinavir-ritonavir combination. I will not go into the details. You can refer to the lecture for with Dr. Tare about the medication. But again, most of the data is there is a very weak evidence, and there is no significant between the groups using it for COVID-19 clearance and the control group. And for the viral load also, it's the same. It's dropping the viral load like the placebo effect. Another important drug, which is remdesivir, which is used mainly for Ebola virus treatment, and it was tried with COVID-19. The important study coming from USA, compassionate use of remdesivir for patients with severe COVID-19 on 53 patients. Actually, the results are not very promising also, because there is a lot of criticism for this study, because they are recruiting some of very stable patients on ambient air and low flow oxygen, patient or non-invasive. Not all patients are very sick on the start of the disease, and the result is not very promising because they have a lot of mortality also. And this group invasive ventilation, there is a 56% here improvement, only 19 patients, while they have 6 patients or 18% who died, and 26 still on invasive ventilation. So the results are not so promising. And one of the criticism to this study also, it was totally guided or sponsored by Gilead, which is the company producing this antiviral remdesivir. And the clinical the conclusion of this study, they observed improvement in 36 out of 53, 68% improvement, and still it's very small sample size. And as I mentioned, there is a lot of criticism. So it's very early, again, to mention any clear data about the remdesivir, is it beneficial or no. Flavipiravir, Avigan, the Japanese drug, also there is some data about it, but still the result is not reliable. And there is ongoing 5 trials in USA, Italy, Japan, but the result will be released by the end of June. Until that time, I think we don't have also enough data to support the use of this drug. This is one of the study done for this one. It's still the result is some showing some beneficial effect, but still it's very small study. Using antibiotic and antifungal is a very important topic also with the use of antiviral, considering the high rate of co-infection with bacteria and fungi. In from the previous report, we have it from the MERS-CoV and from the SARS before and H1N1 in the previous year, that the incidence of bacterial co-infection with the virus, it's starting from 20% up to 75%, especially in severely ill patients. The other important point that it's very difficult to differentiate the bacterial infection from the viral infection based on the clinical and radiological data. And the only proof to document the bacterial infection is to go for culture, bacterial or fungal culture. So you should consider in moderate and in severe cases adding empirical antibiotic and maybe antifungal until we have a clear answer from the micro lab about the sensitivity or the presence of any bacteria. Our protocol, we are starting ceftriaxone and azithromycin for the first 3 days azithromycin and 7 days ceftriaxone. But if the patient will be turned to be severe and severe hypoxia ARDS patient, we are escalating the antibiotic, and my recommendation to follow your local antibiogram and ecology, from which is different from each hospital and each country, and to choose the antibiotic according to your local situation. And adding azithromycin, of course, is beneficial for atypical and because of possible role of antiviral action also. All the people are using azithromycin in combination with other antibiotic. And of course, considering the vancomycin and antifungal coverage mainly for aspergillus is very important if you are suspecting high risk of this point. One important point that you should suspect also the bacterial co-infection if you have high procalcitonin, because the initial COVID-19 should have a normal procalcitonin. So maybe rising procalcitonin is an indicator of bacterial co-infection. Tocilizumab or the Actemra is one promising drug also. It's, as you mentioned, it's immunomodulator or it's given to control the cytokine storm. So it should be related to one of the findings indicating that you have a high cytokine storm, like very high serum interleukin-6 or high ferritin or increasing ferritin or D-dimer. It should be given only twice. Some people are using it for 3 doses, but the maximum recommended is only 2 doses with 12 hours interval between the 2 doses. It has some side effects, infections, activation of serious infection like TB, serious allergic reaction, hepatotoxicity, but it can be tried in very severe life-threatening condition, and it has some promising results in some of the studies, but still need further investigation. Finally, the convalescent plasma also is one of the suggested techniques which is used before in previous viral infection, and it have some positive result. All the data are still very weak. Most of the study are done on 10 patients or less than 10 patients, giving 1 unit of plasma. It's convalescent plasma from previously recovered patient with COVID-19 to have some passive immunity. with a single transfusion of one unit, but still the result it's not very clear. There is some hope from this strategy, but still need to be confirmed more. At least there is no serious effect considered or observed with the application of this technique. Follow-up monitoring is very important to follow up daily all the labs, the procalcitonin, C-reactive protein, interleukin-6, BNP, troponin, and all of this stuff of inflammatory markers, because it's a very good biomarker and we can track the disease severity from the progress of the number and the trend of this increasing lab. Also, monitoring the QT interval is very important and keep an eye on the magnesium and potassium. Routine CT is not recommended, but the follow-up with X-ray and chest ultrasound is enough. And follow-up also of echo closely because of the development of severe cardiomyopathy, and to consider it for right-sided failure with ARDS. So to have a very frequent echo study is very crucial. This is the summary of our protocol in our hospital, considering the general management, as you mentioned, nutrition, GI prophylaxis, vitamin B, vitamin C, D, electrolyte supplementation, avoid nebulization, paracetamol, codeine. The use of anticoagulation we mentioned is very important as a prophylaxis, and consider full anticoagulation also in certain cases. Use of steroids, it's only recommended for refractory septic shock or severe ARDS. Hemodynamic management, focus on the use of dynamic parameters by using ultrasound, echo, or PICO machine to measure the stroke volume variation. Resuscitation by balanced crystalloid, norepinephrine is a drug of choice if the patient starts to be choked, and consider the dobutamine, considering the mixed shock, sometimes septic with cardiogenic shock in this situation. Serial management of lactate and restrictive or balanced fluid strategy is important. Follow-up monitoring of all the labs we mentioned. This is a specific antiviral and antibacterial medication and other treatments. My consideration mainly may be as a promise, my opinion may come from the remdesivir in the next few days or few weeks, and also the tocilizumab, which is a promising drug to be used in very severe cases with high cytokine storm, although the evidence is still lacking to confirm the use of any of this medication in routine practice. My home message is the best treatment for now still is the social distancing, social isolation, hand washing, stay at home for regular personnel, good supportive care, safe ventilatory strategy, adequate understanding of the pathophysiology of respiratory failure, which is complex pathophysiology, and to manage according to the situation in each stage, and management should be tailored regarding the mechanical ventilation. For every patient, individualization of therapy and at each stage of the disease as well. And adequate use of rescue therapy. Major organ support like in renal failure or heart failure. Use of specific medication only in experimental trials and can be tried in life-threatening condition as well. Don't forget, please, all healthcare professionals, don't forget your safety comes first, infection control and wearing the protective equipment is very, very important. At the end, all the data provided represents the best evidence to my knowledge until the 13th of May, but hundreds of studies are released every day and maybe the evidence may change in the near future. Every day while I'm preparing the presentation, I am facing a new studies and I have to change the slides to match with the new data coming. But for the time being, try to stick to the basics, try to protect yourself, and hopefully that this crisis will end very soon and it will be under control. And I hope that the presentation will be useful for all of my colleagues intensivists, and that everyone will be safe and will be able to control this crisis very soon. And thank you very much. Some of the reference I use it. And thank you for your attention.